what he said yesterday.
So we've been, I think, upfront with Ben and letting him know that we, you know, we couldn't have him back under the current contract. And so I think he understands we have some work to do there. I think that those are discussions we'll have with Ben and his representative. And obviously, you know, it takes two to figure that out. And, you know, whether we can agree with what he wants or vice versa, we'll just have to see.
So that's the Steelers side of this. For Roethlisberger's side of this, he told Ed Bouchette of The Athletic that he went to the Steelers first about restructuring the deal. The quote, "I want to do everything I can," and made that very clear to them from the very beginning that it was my idea to basically help the team however I can this year. He added, he, quote, "doesn't care about my pay at all this year." That sounds good. It may not be as simple as that in reality, because there are football considerations here and there are financial considerations. Let's start with the football considerations, Dan. How do you see this from an on-the-field standpoint, the pros and cons of bringing back Ben in Pittsburgh? Dan Orlovsky.
Well, when you talk about...
Dan.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, on the field. That's my fault. I'm sorry. We got two Dans today. That's my bad. Orlovsky, how do you see it from an on-the-field standpoint?
Yeah, whether Big Ben comes back or not should have zero impact on what the Steelers decide to do this year about their future at the position. They have to address who's going to be their next quarterback. Now, if Big Ben comes back, at what price can he come back at for this organization? You know, we watched this team deteriorate at the offensive line this year. They've got some really important free agents, Juju and Bud Dupree and James Conner, that they have to figure out, like, okay, if Big Ben comes back at X number, can we bring one or two of those guys back to help us make a final run? And Greeny, the truth is that this team is chasing other teams now in the AFC. And so that has to factor in the organization's decision of how much they're willing to pay Ben. They are chasing Cleveland. They are chasing Baltimore. They are chasing Buffalo. They're right there with Miami and Indianapolis. And so if they want Big Ben back, it's going to have to be at a significantly cheaper rate. But at the end of the day, they have to figure out who's going to be their next starting quarterback for the next 10 years.
Now, Bart Scott, I mean, always ask the rival. The Raven in you, I know, takes some pleasure in seeing this falling apart. But in your mind, is the Steelers' best course of action to have Ben back next season?
Not at all. You know, Greeny, you either die the hero or live long enough to see yourself become the villain. And I think that's what Big Ben is, because if you look at that playoff game, you know, he looks like a shot fighter, death by a thousand paper cuts. You know, he's checked down Charlie at this point, doesn't push the ball down the field. And at this point of his life, he's not willing to take the hits that made him such a great quarterback, swatting guys away, being able to look down the barrel of the gun and throw and deliver a pinpoint pass. He's not that guy anymore. So for me, it's not any number that Big Ben can come back that play, because I know that it's limitations to where we can go as an organization, where we can go as a team. For me, I think it's Matthew Stafford or bust. That's the perfect quarterback for them right now, the ability for Matthew Stafford to come in there and be your answer and your solution for the next 5 years, and understanding that, hey, this team is in a window where they can kind of, you know, close the gap with a team like Baltimore, with a team like Cleveland, if they have an outstanding quarterback with a live arm that can utilize the entire football field, 53 wide and 100 long.
And so then let me come to Dan Graziano this time, and let's talk about the money piece of this, because there are a lot of considerations there, and they go beyond just the quarterback.
Look, if he comes back on his current contract, the cap hit is $41.25 million. That's what Art Rooney's talking about when he says this can't be done. So they have to make an adjustment. But even if he took a pay cut, which, by the way, would cause other problems, right? The union wouldn't love that precedent of a quarterback taking a pay cut at the end of his career. But even if they restructure the deal and extend it out to reduce the signing bonus proration, the lowest they could get his cap number for this year is about $23 million. So that's a significant reduction, but it still doesn't really solve all their problems, or even most of them, because they're well over the projected cap at this point. They have key free agents, guys like Bud Dupree and Juju Smith-Schuster, that may have to leave if they can't get something figured out cap-wise. They have guys like T.J. Watt and Minkah Fitzpatrick who have contract extensions coming up. The Steelers are in a major pickle, and it may be really difficult for them to field a competitive team this year if they have to bring back Ben Roethlisberger.
Look, the Pittsburgh Steelers are a team that generally we never see rebuild. They just sort of reload on the fly. Part of that has been they've had the great quarterback at this point for two decades. That has helped. We may be seeing the end of that era right before our eyes. Meanwhile, there are other quarterback situations, Graziano. Let's run through a few of those here, and let's start in Carolina. What gives?
Yeah, talk about potential Deshaun Watson destinations. Don't rule out the Panthers. Teddy Bridgewater has $10 million in guaranteed money due this year, but that doesn't mean the Panthers aren't trying to look for potential upgrades. And I wouldn't be surprised to see them jump into the Deshaun Watson mix or the Matthew Stafford mix or possibly another available quarterback down the road, because Bridgewater's only really under control for one more year. They also did hire Sean Ryan as their quarterback's coach, former Texans quarterback's coach, who knows Watson from early in his career. So keep an eye on that. Staying in that division, the New Orleans Saints are expected to lose Drew Brees to retirement. That's the widespread expectation around the league. What do they do at quarterback? Remember, they had Jameis Winston on the roster this year as a backup. He's a free agent, but they are very high on Jameis Winston based on what they saw from him in practice this year. It's entirely possible that the Saints would decide to re-sign Jameis Winston and keep Taysom Hill in his same role going forward. Winston could be Brees' successor. And then we always talk about the San Francisco 49ers because of the way their contracts are structured. Jimmy Garoppolo, no more guaranteed money on that deal. I would expect San Francisco to be poking around about some of these available quarterbacks as well, be it Stafford, be it Watson, be it anybody else who might be coming available in trade, because Garoppolo they like, but they're not ruling out the possibility of upgrading there. And financially speaking, they can get out of Garoppolo's deal very, very easily. So don't rule out the 49ers as a player in some of these talks.
He was in the Super Bowl 2 years ago. I mean, a year ago in actual time. And right now he feels like he's very much on that quarterback carousel. Speaking of the Super Bowl, let's get to that. And let's talk about Tom Brady, who needed just one season in Tampa to get back to the biggest game of the year. Yesterday, Brady was asked about his head coach, Bruce Arians, and he had enormous things to say. Just listen to this.
He's a great man. He's a great leader. He's a great person. He's, you know, a great friend. He's very loyal. He's just got a great way about communicating effectively with everybody around here. And everybody has a great affection for him, for the person he is. There's nobody that ever would say anything bad about BA. He's so endearing to everybody. And I think everyone wants to win for him. Just really excited for him to be recognized in the way that he is. I know he's two-time coach of the year, but just done an amazing job this year with the team in really adverse situations, and just love playing for him.
Huh. Well, wasn't that interesting? Rob Ninkovich, you played with Brady for another coach of some repute by the name of Bill Belichick for an awful long time. And I don't recall Brady ever saying that about Bill. What did you take away from the verbal bouquets Tom just threw in the direction of his new coach?
That was about two dozen red roses right there. I mean, he was over the top about that particular comment on Bruce Arians. And you think about back probably midway through the season, I was saying that they might need to replace the head coach. And now Tom Brady's saying all these wonderful things about Bruce Arians. I wonder if it's because they're in the Super Bowl. I mean, think about it. If they would have lost last week, I'm sure there wouldn't have been such a compliment session on Bruce Arians. But look, I mean, I think halfway through the season, when they went on this 7-game winning streak, they changed a little bit offensively. They protected Tom Moore, which I said was the Achilles heel of this team. So Bruce Arians, maybe he changed a little bit. Maybe from that 7-game winning streak, he's had 25% less pressure. So, I mean, something happened, and Tom likes it.
I can't be the only one. Dan Orlovsky, I'm looking at you. I can't be the only one that as he was talking, all I could think of was Belichick. That there was not the image of Bruce Arians never entered my mind as he was talking. All I could picture was Belichick. How about you?
Yeah, because we never heard Tom, at least while he was playing in New England, speak like this about Bill Belichick. A little bit when he got done there. I think that Tom Brady loves two things, team and sacrifice. And I think Bruce Arians has really embodied that this year. In many ways, he's empowered Tom Brady in ways that we just didn't get to see in the past in New England. You know, like so often coaches, and Ninko and Bart know this, like they think they know everything. And so the player is always underneath them and they talk to players. And I think Bruce Arians talked with Tom Brady this year and gave him the ability to take ownership of this offense and ownership of the football team. And he put the team first. Nico talked about some of the adjustments post-bye week, that potential golf foursome, right? And then the sacrifice of Bruce Arians going, you know what, Tom, like, I am going to step a little bit to the side. And I do want you to take over a little bit. And I think that Brady has absolutely loved that. Brady has loved the empowerment from his coach. So I don't think Tom is just like throwing flowers here. I think he's just sharing exactly how he feels when it comes to Bruce Arians, that he's embodied the two most important things to Tom Brady, team and sacrifice.
Yeah, he's empowered him in some ways. I mean, Arians said, I just let him coach sometimes. I sit back and watch. Bart Scott, what do you think?
Yeah, because I wonder what the narrative would have been early on in the season. You know, I think that the really the pivotal week where they kind of came to and the two minds came and said, hey, listen, Tom, I'm going to allow you to do what you need to do, was during that bye week, because I think that's when everything changed. That's when they figured out what's their best personnel. You know, they were bouncing around and no risky, no bisky. Well, no risky is putting Tom Brady at risk. You're going back there, and Tom Brady didn't sign up to go back there and hit his head off the turf. You know, I think when they decided to go with two tight ends on the field, it opened.